皆さん、こんにちは。一橋ビジネススクール ICS。
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Emi Osono, professor of 一橋 Business School ICS. Thank you very much for participating in Porter Prize Conference on Competitiveness 2021. Porter Prize is to promote competitiveness in Japanese enterprises. So 2001, 一橋 ICS established it. This prize and maximum 4 companies have been selected each year. So until to date, 74 companies have received this prize. A national university being able to continue this kind of prize for so long is thanks to our sponsors. I would like to extend my deepest gratitude to Mitsubishi UFJ Morgan Stanley Securities Co. Ltd. and also to many, many corporate supporting us, PWCW Create Company, and also creating the criteria and giving us lots of advice, Professor Michael E. Porter and Professor Hirotaka Takeuchi of Harvard Business School, thanks to you, and also ICS organizing committee members and staffs, and also to all of you related members who have been helping us. I would like to express my deepest gratitude. Today we have 3 companies who have received the 2021 Porter Prize. We would like to explain to you about the strategies of each company, and I hope it will work as some kind of stimulus to everyone who is attending today's conference. But even before going into the content of today's conference, I would like to ask Kazuo Ichijo, Professor Dean of Hitotsubashi Business School ICS, for his opening remarks. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Ichijo, Professor Dean of Hitotsubashi Business School, ICS. As organizer, I would like to introduce a little bit about our Hitotsubashi ICS. Actually, its proper name is Hitotsubashi Business School International Competitiveness, International Company Strategy. We have in short, we call it ICS, and we offer programs of global MBA, EMBA education, and boutique size, which means small, and bespoke, which means tailor-made education provided to each student. That is our policy. And based on this policy, we are trying to create leaders who will contribute to the common good, pursuing greater good through innovation. We call these members wise leaders. This is our mission, to foster wise leaders. Our Hitotsubashi ICS, we started in 2000, the organization before our ICS, and there was something very important that happened. QS ranking, this happened this year, QS ranking, a highly accepted ranking, and we were able to become number one MBA in Japan. We are very, very delighted to receive this ranking. And also July this year, a first time in national university, we were able to receive AACSB accreditation. This means that our business school is providing the highest of education as business school. Now, this shows that what we are providing is of the highest selection. I think that this is the evaluation given to our 2 decades of work. In ICS, we are providing high quality education, which is globally recognized. And this ICS MBA, EMBA, DBA, and executive course, this is providing top of the edge, highest quality education, and we are able to foster human resource of highest quality. We want to maintain and even enhance our education. This year, becoming number one ranked in Japan MBA in the QS ranking and also accreditation from a global organization. This is a very important milestone for us, the 20 years of education and the Porter Prize and the activity that we have conducted in the past years. This has been very important to us too. We are going to the next two decades in there. I believe that our actions of Porter Prize and Conference on Competitiveness will continuously be an integral part of us. We want to continue to learn with you and continue discussion with you to build the future. Thank you very much. This is my opening remark.
From now on, we will introduce the strategies of the prize winners of this year. We have Cainz, we have JINS, and Kurashicom as our Porter Prize winners this year. Porter Prize is about competitive strategy. And the corporate the competitive strategy is the requirement for applying for the Porter Prize. Usually, companies have business strategic business or department. And this time, these companies, three of them, all of them, have a very good strategies as a company. So these three companies received the award. First, Professor Noma is going to give the financial analysis, and then it will be followed by the interview by Professor Kusunoki on the prize winners. Hello, this is Noma from Hitotsubashi Business School SBA. 2021 Porter Prize Conference on Competitiveness is now held today. I'd like to express my appreciation to all the stakeholders, including Mitsubishi UFJ Morgan Stanley Securities. The essence of the competitive strategy is the differentiation in Porter Prize in management and operation. The differentiation is provided against competitors and take intentional strategies to move forward in the industry are chosen. We look at the originality of the strategy. So we tend to focus on the strategy itself, but profitability as well as the accounting figures and original and unique ideas on the accounting are also equipped to these companies. So today I'd like to talk about these unique aspects of the accounting perspectives of the prize winners. In Porter Prize, we have two stages of the screening. First, we look at the profitability and unique value and constant strategy as well as innovation supporting strategy. In the second screening, we look at the efficient capital usage, value chain trade-off, and the fitness. First, looking at Cainz, we will look at ROIC and ROS as the choosing criteria. ROIC on the left, ROS on the right. First, you can see the industry upper quartile, median, and lower quartile. And before looking at these numbers, for ROIC and ROS, the y-axis differs. For example, for ROIC, Cainz has the range from 0 to 20, but for ROS, the range is from 0 to 10. First, ROIC and ROS, what I'd like to say here is that between ROIC and ROS, compared to other companies in industry, compared to upper quartile or median in the industry, Cainz has higher figures. And the second point is that the difference against these numbers is even higher in ROS than in ROIC. Nakamura-san earlier said that between US and Japan, the companies in Japan do not take risks. But between 2016 and 2019, Cainz ROIC went down slightly. It may be because of the investment in the digital area. Next on Kurashicom, Kurashicom ROIC and ROS. Of course, ROS is high, but more prominent difference is seen in ROIC. In 2020, ROIC in Kurashicom was 41.1, which is extremely high. Upper quartile is 20%, top 20% of the industry, which is about 20. So in the PL, the unique strategy is reflected. But to ROIC or to balance sheet, looking at the average invested capital, we can see a clear difference and a clear superiority to other players in the market. Now, JINS, looking at ROS, ROS in JINS is double the upper quartile ROS in the industry. Corporate governance code was announced in 2011, and the capital principle was introduced there. But JINS ROIC in 2020 was 24.8%. So it is overwhelmingly high in the industry, but at the same time, it exceeds significantly the capital cost. The profit is much higher than the invested capital. So I showed the superiorities of these prize winners to other players in the market, but these numbers are underlined by unique ideas on accounting. First, on Cainz in Harvard Business Review, there was an interview article with the president, and he said that there are six criteria to look at the reform. First is cash, second is profit or loss that generates cash. Unless we have profit, we cannot use cash. Cainz is unlisted, and Cainz is a family business, so it's easier for them to gain understanding with the shareholders. They always look toward 5 to 10 years from now. And he said that this much time is required to radically change business value. So I think that what's important is that he is highlighting cash more than profit. And long-term strategy requires 5 to 10 year span. The listed companies in Japan, a non-founder company, or company where founder is not operating the company, usually president or CEO is replaced about every six years, both in Japan and in the US. But in the US, volatility of the term is higher. For example, some may resign in 1 year, but others may continue for 20 years. But today, in Japan, looking at the median and average, the president is usually replaced every 6 years or so. So it's more like a relay of CEOs. And if that's the case, it's very difficult to carry out the long-term strategy. So cash is very important in driving long-term strategy. That's what Cainz is showing. Now, Kurashicom is also an unlisted company, so information is limited. But as we interviewed them, what was interesting is that they have unique accounting practice and unique idea on accounting. Why do they set KPI? It is to predict and forecast demand. On a daily basis, they forecast demand and create the projection. Aoki-san said that when the approach is right, then it always hits a mark. It's an idea in Japanese archery. But increasing the corporate value is important for both listed and unlisted companies. But increasing corporate value and profitability is not an ultimate goal. It is supposed to be just a mere result. He says that people tend to say that when the approach is right, it hits a mark. But I think that he's always hits. He always focuses on the fact that to hit the bullseye, the company is taking the right approach. Now, Professor Nonaka doesn't really talk about figures or numbers, but when he had the talk with Mitarai-san in Canon, he said that he uses balance sheet to create the story. So earlier I said that there was a big gap in ROIC. Looking at the JINS Holdings balance sheet, what's unique is that the inventory turnover is it's quite different from the company, the industry average. So JINS Holdings does not only have the uniqueness in accounting practice, it also has unique operating practice, and CCC cash conversion cycle is shorter than other players, which might be supporting their growth. And prominent difference is shown in PBR, the market value over the capital, it is 7.5. There are many Japanese companies that have less than one for PBR, but it's 7.5 for JINS Holdings. Such unique strategy is appreciated by the stock market and also reflected in PBR. So it's similar to the earlier concept, when the approach is right, it hits a mark. JINS Holdings probably is not doing their business to increase PBR, but I think that their unique practice is reflected in PBR as well as the trust by the stock market. That concludes my presentation. Please take a look at Porter Prize website announcement.
Hello everyone. Thank you very much for being with us. I am Ken Kusunoki, Professor of Hitotsubashi Business School ICS. Professor Takeuchi said moral purpose. Professor Takeuchi mentioning that word, I was moved. It is truly the world of VUCA. He has changed a lot, I thought. Professor Takeuchi talking about moral purpose, then I think that moral purpose is extremely important. I was able to understand once again. And as a result of that, when we looked at the financial status of the companies, well, Professor Noma, he is the best in analyzing financial data in Japan now. So I think we can find out many things, and also the result is brought by its strategy. There are many prizes which evaluate companies based on outcome, but the reasons behind that, which means evaluating the strategy of companies, that is the uniqueness and why are Porter Prizes important. I have been involved in Porter Prize for a long time from the beginning, but speaking about simply evaluating a strategy, it sounds easy, but very difficult. We have to look into the details intricately, and not just looking at the data, but we have conducted interviews with the leaders of the companies multiple times, and we were able to select three companies for Porter Prize this year. Later, we would like to hold an interview. Of course, time is limited, but I would like to deep dive into their strategies as much as possible. But even before that, well, I am in the camp of competitive strategy for a long time. And every time I learn a lot through this operation of Porter Prize, operating Porter Prize, and I learn a lot. What is the best strategy? It is my asset. Until the people say stop, I want to be involved and continue to be in Porter Prize. If I'm not on the stage anymore in the future, please think, oh, he was told to quit. I am putting in my full effort for this prize. We have our members watching us via Zoom. Though time is limited, we would like to receive your questions as much as possible. So through Zoom Q&A function, ask us anything. We would like to choose the questions, and we would like to ask the questions directly to the leaders of the companies. Don't ask us through the chat function, through the Q&A function, please. Without further ado, we would like to ask Mr. Masayuki Takaya, President and CEO of Cainz Corporation.
Takaya-san,
thank you very much for coming, and congratulations on winning the Porter Prize. Yes, I am honored to receive this award. I'd like to say thank you once again. I'm sure that many people know Cainz, many consumers know Cainz. And this time, there are two things that I should highlight. One is that in previous fiscal year, the workman received Porter Prize. And just like Cainz, that company is also in Basia Group. So from the single corporate group, two companies received Porter Prize. This is the first time in the history of Porter Prize. And it shows the characters of Porter Prize. We look at the business, not the company, when we select Porter Prize winner. So business is providing value to the market by differentiating itself from others. So we are focusing on business. And another point is that in the home improvement industry, there is a severe competition, not only the existing companies, but you are also competing against the drugstores. And also in general merchandise category, you are competing against 100 yen stores. And also when it comes to furniture, you are competing against Nitori and also ASKO when it comes to office appliances. And Momotaro is another competitor that you have. So there is a severe competition, and industry itself is quite mature. Yes, in 2005, the market was about 4 trillion yen, and it's been stable. So in the home improvement market, it's quite mature, and there's nothing hopeful in this market. But still, I think the end of opportunity is the beginning of strategy. when there are many winds blowing to push you ahead, then you can just capture that wind. But then once the opportunity is lost, then you will have to have a good strategy. So I think that such high profitability in your company is driven by a strategy. So again, ROS is much higher than that of the industry. And ROIC or ROIC, well, it's quite strange. ROS is not ROS, but ROIC is ROIC. ROI is also ROI. No one call it ROI, but only ROIC is called ROIC. It's not ROIC. In any case, ROIC, ROIC is also very high. I think you have very different strategy. In the first term, you were just positioned as a discounter and you were just trying to capture the market growth. And then you moved on to becoming SBA with private brand. And now you are in a new stage. You are focusing on creating customer value. Can you talk about that? Yes. The home improvement market has been stable and it's not growing from the 4 trillion yen size. But to begin with, there is no such market as home improvement market. Some items are in the general merchandise store or some items are in the drugstore market. And when we combine all of them, then the market size is about 4 trillion yen. It's not growing, but the number of home improvement centers is increasing, which means that it's about multiplication. So each company's profit is going down as a result. So looking at Japanese market alone, this market is not going to grow significantly. We cannot expect that. If that's the case, traditionally, we were getting the shares of the items from other companies and vice versa. But as retailers, we were getting shares from each other in any case. As we heard earlier, looking at the value and growth in 10 years' time, then new value creation is a must. So it's at the procurement and sales. So we expanded the number of stores and we increased the sales. And then in the second stage, Cainz started selling private brand and unique items. And now we are on the third stage, creating additional values. The key is the digitalization. 10 years from now, we will continue to be a physical retailers, but on top of that, we will need digital sphere. On top of physical stores, we need the contact with our customers in different ways. And we are also going back to the origin and the founding spirit. More than 60 years ago, Cainz was established, and the third principle is to create culture through our business. More than 60 years ago, this was already a founding spirit of this company. Recently, we have focused on increasing profit, focusing on our business. But once again, we are looking at the founding spirit for the communities and for the society. Just as we heard, we need to co-create with the community. And to achieve that, we should not just pursue our profit, but also should create value for the community. That should be our core business, using digital and social value. These two aspects are the new values that we will create going forward. And if we do that, then we might no longer be home improvement centers or retailers. But in any case, that's the direction we are heading. Listening to you, I thought that as an outsider looking into the market, of course, when the market is mature, then M&A takes place and then the companies are consolidated to expand that scale. Some players do that. But on the other hand, based on the categories of items, some companies may narrow down to a particular category and concentrate on that. But Cainz is not relying on M&A and continuing organic growth. Is that the right understanding? It's both yes and no. It's not necessarily that we would never use M&A. If there's any opportunity, then we won't negate such opportunities. But as I said, we do have the growth strategy. So it's not just about scaling up through M&A. That is not aligned to our basic management style. So once again, the business value needs to be created. And if there's a player who will contribute to creating our business value, then M&A is an option. So I cannot say as the head of the company that we will never do M&A. But M&A is not an option to pursue the scale of economy of scale. Right, we won't do that. So what is new value? Let's look into that. In the second stage, you became SBA and started launching private brand items. Until that point, the item by item number or article number, you were developing new products. But now in the new value creation stage, you have a theme, and based on the theme, you are creating value. For example, one theme is, let's make the house chore easier, or the living with pets. Then based on that theme, you create products and create the shop floor. So what are the successful examples that you can share with us? Well, conventionally, we created items based on item numbers. For example, we have frying pan item number. And if that's one category, then the person in charge would develop new products of frying pan, competing against others and comparing with competing products. And they were trying to make them sturdier, etc. The reason why they were making frying pans sturdier, it's because there were needs from consumers. But why do they want the frying pans to be sturdier? It's because they want to make house chore easier, cooking easier. And to make cooking easier, the frying pan should be lighter weight. And to make cooking easier, we shouldn't only focus on frying pan. How can we shorten the time to prepare breakfast in the morning? What are the sets of tools that are required to achieve that? So when we look at that, it's not just about developing frying pans or pots. We need the cross-sectoral approach for the kitchen. So the person who was in charge of developing pet product, they were only focusing on pet product. But when we look at living with pet as a theme, then we need to look at curtains as well, because if you live with pets, you might not like the smell, and then you want the curtain that can be deodorant. That would make living with pet more comfortable. So in the traditional way of developing new products, that way of thinking was not emerging. But now we have these themes, and based on these themes, we are trying to develop new products. we made this shift a few years ago. So the room that's standalone, that is a great product. But at the same time, this product was developed under the theme of making house show easier. And these products are displayed in the store following the theme. And also you have e-commerce. It's not just about e-commerce. It's offline to online or online to offline. It's the linkage with the offline to generate synergy. What's your idea? Yes. E-commerce sales, e-commerce profitability, and EC ratio. We were trying to increase all of that. That was our KPI in the past. But whether customers will buy the products in EC or not, it's just the difference of where they are making payment. If the customer is to choose a product, maybe the customer has went through a lot of research online, and then finally the customer may want to look at the weight or the look and feel of the product physically in the store. And then the customer would probably buy the product in physical store. But actually the customer has done in-depth research online and then made a purchase in a store. But for us, it is the in-store purchase, and that's how we look at the ratio and figures, but that is not that important. How can we enrich the experience for customers? That's the important point. Large-scale stores are trying to invite customers to the store as much as possible. They are putting a lot of items on the shelf and then trying to make the shop floor attractive so that the customer would buy the products in the store. But that's not important. What's important is that customers have objectives and purposes even before they come to the store. And what's more important is after they left the store, after they buy the frying pan, will their cooking become really easier? That is more important. And connecting the store and customers is the more important aspect. So it's not just about increasing EC ratio. The connection with customers is what we are focusing on, especially in Cainz. Cainz deal products that are used in daily lives. So the natural way of exploring products in the store is really demonstrated. So if you haven't looked at Cainz EC shop, I hope you will visit their store website because it's very well designed. Everyone talks about digital, but the systems and sites should be developed internally in order to make them really effective. And you have that organization, right? Yes. When we started our strategy a few years ago, we didn't have a digital aspect then, so it was a zero start. Now we have 130 members in the team to develop the digital platform internally, because when we are to create interface with customers, we need continuous improvement every day. We cannot create something complete on day one. We have a lot of inquiries and complaints from customers, and then based on that, we continuously improve the platform. And traditionally, we would ask the vendor, and then the vendor would take 3 months to develop that, but that is not speedy enough. in order to create customer points effectively, we needed to develop the platform internally. So that is the big investment. And that's why the ROIC went down slightly. Yes. Then let's take some questions. Yes, we received many questions regarding ROIC. Seems like everyone's interested in why ROIC went down, but you answered that just now. So let's look at the question from Kinoshita-san in the future. Japan is depopulating and aging. So since Noma-san was talking about long-term view, in 2050, what will happen to the home center industry? Well, we are in the VUCA world. So if we think that the things are going clockwise, then things may be going counterclockwise by 2050. So I cannot predict the future accurately. So how long in the future do you have strategy for? Well, 10 years strategy or 10-year vision is already there. So as a management, we do have that idea. Obviously, 10 years from now, we will have physical stores. Usually it's about 10,000 square meter area in average for our physical stores, but we are thinking that this will be completely different in the future. We have nicely organized shelves and aisles, and a lot of items are packed on the shelves. So we are trying to improve the efficiency of sales in these shop floors, but purchasing items is something that we can do in EC already. So what value are we going to propose in the 10,000 square meter area store? That is what we are thinking about. So you're already starting that experiment. Yes. So no one knows what will happen in 2050, but what is clear is that what will happen to home center industry? The category of home center industry will probably be gone by then. Right. And Takeuchi-san talked about universality. So again, things will change drastically, but going back to the founding spirit, you said that you are creating culture for people in the community. So that may not change even in 2050. Yes, I think so. Creating culture sounds quite grand, but in 2050, there will be communities for sure. And of course, there will be social challenges. When we established our company, the issue was that the physical supplies were not available in rural areas, but now we are facing with depopulation, aging of the society, and the medical supplies or medical facilities in shortage. So daily life is becoming difficult in some areas. But with the traditional concept of retailer, a retailer would think that if the market is shrinking, they wouldn't open new stores and they start withdrawing their outlets. But what we think is that we want to be present there to enrich the lives of people in the community. Towards 2050, I think that kind of idea will be necessary. Now we talk about personal and emotional. These are very important dimensions these days. So in 2050, looking toward the future, that concept may be even stronger. So Takaya-san, thank you very much. This concludes the interview with Cainz.
Next. Yes, we heard from Cainz. So next, we would like to have an interview with Mr. Kohei Aoki, CEO of Kurashicom Inc.
Once again,
welcome Mr. Aoki from Kurashicom, and congratulations again for Porter Prize. Yes, I am truly honored. You are in Kunitachi City, Tokyo. I have my past memories, not a good memory in Kunitachi City. Yeah, not related to today's interview, but I have to make an apology to you. I think many of you know Kurashicom, Kokuo Kurashi no Doguten. It's an e-commerce site of Nordic lifestyle. But first, when I saw your business, I didn't understand the strategic importance or how interesting it is. I thought that it's just an e-commerce site focusing on lifestyle. But this time, finally, I noticed that it's such an exciting strategy. I apologize and I'm embarrassed that I couldn't understand fully your strategy, but Kokuo Kurashi no Doguten, an EC store, a store that sells Nordic lifestyle goods on the internet. So through your products, selling the world, an idea and lifestyle community will be created, especially since internet flourished. Everyone's thinking about the same thing around the world. However, at the end of the day, no one was able to realize that, which means that creating that kind of world, everyone tried but couldn't do it. But your company is able to achieve that in a near perfect way through Hokuo Kurashi no Doguten website. So I want to ask, why couldn't anyone else do it? Maybe a philosophy or a way of thinking, I should say. I think that started from William Morris, art and craft movement. From that, I think it was the real beginning. But would you explain that? Well, I'm not an expert, of course, so I would just explain briefly. But through the after the Industrial Revolution, there were more and more goods, but they were of low quality, and the people, everyday life goods, the quality is very low. So William Morris thought that he wants to fulfill and satisfy everyday life of the usual general people's life to become more rich and of high quality. So looking into the details of everyday life and finding out happiness in the lives of common people. This is the starting point of when we decided to create our products. And also the Nordic lifestyle goods too. Think that the designers are impacted by William Morris, and our company is also impacted by William Morris. So not about others, how we are looked at by others, but actually how do you look at yourself, or how do you look at your life? Not having a glamorous life, which that will be appreciated by others, but what is the rich lifestyle of yours? I think this is a kind of value and the view of the world which has been continuing for centuries. This is the core of our business. And there are many people who empathize with this way of thinking. So next, when we try to turn that into business, and as Noma-san analyzed, your business is a highly profitable business. I think this is not something easy, turning it into business. I believe if there's someone having the same idea as yours and they want to turn it into a business, then they want to start to do something. Of course, when they think about they want to make it into business, then they want to bring in a reason into it, reasonable business, making it into a reasonable business. But if you do so, then you fail. So what you did was e-commerce as a foundation of culture. This is what you established, I think. So that's the high level idea. And when I look at the KPIs set by your companies, then you prioritize in the number of engagements, which means usual e-commerce, their KPI is usually focused on the number of visitors or average per purchase per users. And how many visitors purchase, the ratio of the buyers. And that is different from the number of engagement, I think. Why do you prioritize engagement? Yes, number of visitors and how many items are purchased, for example, that is also important. But the customers who want to visit our website, increasing the number of customers trying to visit our website, if we try to take action based on that, our pillar of our business is e-commerce. But regardless of what they are going to purchase, we want customers who've decided what they want to buy. That's the best way. But if we try to fight against Rakuten or Amazon, we can't win. And of course, real store is Cainz. Yeah, they will all visit Cainz. And also, if it's eyewear, they'll go to JINS. So our competitor being the global giant, Amazon, there's one part that we might be able to win, which means capturing the people who have time, plenty of time. So not people who want to go to Facebook or Instagram. Of course, they cannot basically shop in Instagram or Twitter. So, well, sometimes you can, but we are a retailer, so we decided to focus that maybe we will be able to capture the visitors who haven't yet decided what to buy, because if they've already decided, then they will just go to Amazon. That is why we decided that we will try to focus on the visitors or customers, potential customers who haven't yet decided what to buy. That's why we decide to focus on engagement, and maybe we can create the trigger to decide their purchase. And when they one day come up with something that they want to buy, then they will think about us. That's why engagement is important for us. I thought which was very exciting. You're looking at an e-commerce site. Well, some parts are similar from other companies, but I noticed that the process is different, which I mean, usually you start off with the product, and to promote the product and to sell the product, what we have to do. That's the contents or story or video associated with the product. But the order of their process is different, which I mean by not starting from the product, but starting from the contents or the story. Yes. It's difficult to see from outside, but actually when you look at our product page, it shows our unique characteristic. For example, if there's a 500 yen product and a 50,000 yen product, in each of the page, the cost which will be put in, usually from a retailer's view, you would put in more effort for the 50,000 yen product. That's a so-called promotion budget, right? Yes. But for us, the product page, or I should say, we want to build the contents which our customers will be most excited or interested in, is the contents related to the product. Because like the fashion magazine, it's like a catalog about the product when we talk about the essence. So the product related articles and the contents shall be the most interesting page, which means even if it's a 50,000 yen product or 500 yen product, the investment should be the same. It has to be a product page which everyone can fully enjoy. And if we have that, then the sales will be made and we will surely see the outcome. So at the end of the day, the purchased amount and the action of purchase that will come following your enriched contents. That's right. And I also was quite surprised the number of SKU. A similar company in the industry may be like 150th or so SKU. So number of SKU is very small compared to competitors. And the community brings in people with similar ideas, similar way of thinking. So what they select is decided, and also maybe you sometimes make private brands. So the contents for each of the product is extremely rich, but not a whole variety of products, a focused variety of products you have. And what I heard is from the committee members of Porter Prize, Kurashicom sends lots of emails to their customers, and usually EC shops emails are the first deleted, not interesting. What Osono-san was saying, but your email is so interesting that he doesn't want to delete it. He wants to read it. I think so. Yours is an exception, and also, of course, Cainz and JINS. But your how you prioritize things is totally different from competitors. We can find that out from your example about your promotional emails. And you don't have someone who specializes in marketing. You don't do any kind of mass marketing. Takeuchi-san was mentioning something about outside into inside out, but sort of like an ultimate kind of inside out that you are doing. You're not starting from the product that you think it will sell, but rather you are producing products which you want to sell, which you think people will want or you want. That's why you have products which the staffs chose, like staff's choice products. And we often hear keywords like motivation, and also the products. When one product is really viral, then you will analyze later why that product sold well. Why do you take that kind of procedure or method? Well, I should say it's not that we are not doing any marketing, but I think, to put it in other words, every activity is marketing. Everything we do is marketing. Things which are overlooked by other people are not interested in, we want to shed light on it. That's maybe called marketing for us. And creating a product which we do not need marketing, everyone will want it anyways, or making a situation or environment everyone will notice it. That's what we focus. For example, June, we decided to go into the film industry to show the film everywhere in Japan. Of course, we think that movies are important itself, but well, I think people wondered why our company goes into that film industry. I think people were surprised, and they thought why, but it's not totally different from what our business. So I think people understood a little bit and actually got more interested in our company. And as Professor Noma said, if naturally people get interested in us, then that will build cash. Then if we are cash abundant, then we will have a surplus time or a surplus resource that we will be able to put in to analyze the situation or maybe reflect on ourselves why that product solved. And talking about SKU, I think maybe there are companies which will send out 100 SKU per season, but we will send out about 10 per season, so 1/10 of other competitors maybe sometimes. Yes, and peace, liberty, and hope. That's the core of your thoughts, right? Liberty, peace, and hope. Well, I think that it's some sort of like a policy message by politicians just listening to you, to these words, but I think it's a truly strategic move of your company. First of all, liberty, which means that you do everything in-house, your systems in-house. You do not depend on other companies. You are totally independent and free to do what you want to do. That's liberty. And talking about peace, having your unique position, you won't be compared with others. And you won't have to go into a total battlefield. That brings peace to you and hope, which means you do something which only brings a virtuous cycle. The more you do it, there will be asset accumulated and you will continue your business. So that is Kurashicom's liberty, peace, and hope. I think it really shows the true strategy of a company. You've been holding this idea since founding. Well, our mission is to build a life which fits. So each and every person can find out their life which feels that it fits them and they will be satisfied. A company trying to propose that kind of lifestyle, we will have to do it by ourselves first. And to be able to do that, what is needed? Then I first thought we don't want to be dominated by others. So because if we have to listen to others and follow them, even if we don't want to, then it means it won't fit. And we don't want to compete in an area we don't want to. That's not good either. And if we are worried about next year's budget, then we cannot create a life with fit. So the essential points would be liberty, peace, and hope. That's why it became the pillar of our management. Yeah, it's more than, I didn't think that we should establish a strategy, but rather I came up with that idea from the starting point that we want to provide a lifestyle which fits everyone. The form is important. The form or the method you take is important. If that form or shape is proper or right, then you will be able to hit the target. That's also what you try to explain. And I also feel the dynamism for the future. It's you were saying like your business is trying to develop a new hot spring resort. We sell products, contents, publishing, and also the PR. So we are asked, what's your business, core business? But I sometimes say we're like a developer of an hot spring resort, because first for that resort, that hot spring will be the core. The hot spring experience will be is wonderful. So there will be people who want to stay in that hot spring and they want to stay there. Then there would be the need for accommodation, hotels, and they enjoy the experience of the hot spring. They want to take back something home, and that will be the souvenir business. And then the accommodation, hotel, and the hot spring, if both of it is great, even if both of it is wonderful, if we run out of hot spring water, then we cannot continue business. But if the hot spring itself is great, then there will be the methods of transportation. More and more people will come. That's why it's very important that we focus on our core business. It's not the souvenir shop or the hotel business. The most important thing is the rich hot spring experience and continue to maintain the water so the hot spring won't dry out, and also keep the hot spring clean. That's the core business. So hot spring, you say, would be your lifestyle and your idea, philosophy, the cultural platform. That is your hot spring. Yes, that is true. Long ago, there was Hobonichi-san. Hobonichi in 2012 Porter Prize winner, and their strategy was really, really great. Half of your business is similar, but half is different. The half which is different is you don't have Ito Ishige Sato in your company. That's true. And like Hobonichi, they have like their daily planners, a super hit product. Your company doesn't have that kind of super hit product yet, I think. Well, Hobonichi, their way of selling is also great, but what's the difference between your company, Hobonichi? People probably will say you guys are similar. Well, I'm not in a position to talk about Hobonichi because Hobonichi is truly the front runner of our kind of business. Yeah, true community business. Like, they are really in the paramount, and their business is a kind of a business which found a totally new route to climb up to the top of the mountain. But I think talking about social capital, Ito Ishige Sato has several 10 billion yen worth, I think. That's the asset of how famous Ito Ishige Sato. And also, they have their super hit daily planner. Yeah, just with their daily planner, a paper diary, they are selling. Yeah, Hobonichi, they can create so much asset and money. Yes, with just their contents. Oh, yes, they're great. But what we were inspired by Hobonichi, we don't want to continue just respecting a Hobonichi for 10 years, 20 years. So I don't want you to misunderstand, but I feel that it was actually good that we want to build a business that we can think, oh, it's good that we didn't have Ito Ishige Sato or that mega hit daily planner in our company, which means we shouldn't be dependent on one single product or one single charisma person. And Itoi-san, he's a person who was in the advertisement or promotion industry. That is why I think he has a very strong mindset that he won't take promotional measures. Well, if Itoi-san's not going that way, then we can go that way, actually. That's why we decided to go into the PR business, too. So it's not like I can compare with him and differentiate with him, but I think we try to be in the sort of like we are a successor or being in that kind of group. He's the mainstream and the main family, and we are sort of like in that same group, but taking a little bit of a different path. Yeah, so Porter Prize, we have a lot of diversification, but you come from the same group. Yep, like Hobonichi group. And also maybe like Nidec group. Oh, Nidec group, that's a very, very strong kind of group, I think. But this year we had lots of a lifestyle category companies. Thank you very much. Any question coming in for Kurashicom? Yeah, short question. Number one, the entry point. Well, I buy your socks, like all the colors that you sell in your EC. But until you came to us, I didn't know I was buying from you. So e-commerce usually they put in huge investment in order to capture their first customer. So for your Kurashicom, what's the entry point for your customers? And the second question is Liberty, which means that you need to grow your own capability. So capability should be in-house. You don't need to depend on your suppliers. That's where you're aiming for. But looking at your contents, it's all high quality. Like if it's like when we explain it a Netflix way, your capability density is extremely high, I think. But how do you in-house your skill? How do you maintain your high-level capability? Like, I also hear that you really hire people, choose people, like 200 people apply and you only choose one person. Well, maybe it's different from Netflix. You will make someone quit even if they're sufficient. Entry point is basically through our articles, SNS contents, or maybe video clips, podcast, movie. We have tons of package and contents that we are sending out every day. And the trigger will be people being interested in one of our contents. How we allocate our promotional expense. I talk about allocation, but promotion contents investment cost is extremely high. For example, 5 billion yen business, and if it's 10%, it will be 500 million yen promotional expense, but that will be very low, actually. That will be in the lower side in the EC business. But if we had 500 million yen, then it means that people who have 5 million yen earnings people to come in, income people to buy our products. We need 100 of them. But like, how can, is it, do we need, can we pay that amount of cost? We have like 70 or 80 per employees in a company now. So we should think more about the cost efficiency or effectiveness, because like 500 million yen, are we going to pay that much of amount? So rather than paying for the promotional cost, it's much better to pay for our creative human resource, because it will be much cheaper if we are able to have these people in-house, the creative people in-house, to work on these promotional activities. And also related to what to that, I would like to explain. Well, I've been talking about culture, and also the rituals will be important in our business. And if how we are going to teach it in a logical way, or maybe have like a guideline or a manual, people are trying to do that. But I think that is actually the most ineffective way of teaching a culture, because the style will change every day, even if we try to provide a manual. So I think it's best that we should align our value and also the aesthetics. So it's important how we hire the people and newly employed people. Everyone will have their individual mentors and stay with them for at least half a year. A photographer said to foster a good photographer, show them picture A and B and let them choose which is better, and do that maybe 100 times to teach a new photographers, and they will learn by comparing A to B 100 times. So that's very close to what we are doing. We are trying to educate people in sort of a craftsmanship type of way, and we are trying to select the people as much as possible. And of course, what Kurashicom is pursuing, your philosophy and idea, is the members should be deeply empathizing with that. So you are very careful how you employ your members. So how you employ is through your own media, right? You're not ordering external recruitment media, but in your own media, you advertise, you're going to put on article for recruitment. Yeah, 80% of our employees are ex-customers. So since they were our customers, they understand fully about our values and what we take importance in, and they feel that they want to be on our side to send information and communicate. I talk about Takarazuka fans. Takarazuka fans, Takarazuka theater fans, I think they truly have a very, very core fan club. So they first watch through videos and then they visit the theater. And then at the end of the day, I think their ultimate commitment of the fan is they would want their daughter to be a part of the Takarazuka theater. I think what we are doing is very quite similar. The customers who love us, their ultimate commitment will become a member of our company. So we think that it's very important that we have the power that our customers will feel how wonderful it would be to be a part of this company. So to maximize the power, I think we have to maximize our power and bring satisfaction to our customer. It is related to that too. So not just bringing in, if we just bring in a customers in a company continuously, that's not enough. But I think we can't be perfect at all time, but we want our employees to be satisfied so that our customers will feel that, oh, it was good that I chose to be a member of this company. So you are choosing only one person out of 200 applicants. There's a labor shortage, but in your company, there's nothing like a labor shortage. There are so many people who wants to become a part of your company. I think it shows the power of your company through that example. Okay, thank you very much for the questions. Mr. Aoki of Kurashicom, thank you for being with us. Thank you very much.
Now the third prize winner from JINS Holdings, I'd like to call upon Mr. Ryo Tanaka, director of JINS Holdings. Tanaka-san, thank you very much for joining us, and congratulations on winning Porter Prize. The slides show that JINS has a long history, and I think that many members of the audience are the actual users and customers of JINS. So in Japan, we see ZOF and JINS and Owndays. There are many stores of eyeglasses around Japan, and we see many companies, and they are all SPAs, and they design and sell their own products. It seems quite normal in Japan, but is it unique to Japan? Yes, in Asia, there are similar business formats that are coming up, but Japan has the most numbers. I see. In Japan, there are many regulations. Regulations are quite tight. But when it comes to eyeglass industry, it's a medical equipment, and there's vested interest and the regulations are very tight. But in Japan, this industry was quite free of regulations, right? In the US, the persons have to be licensed to sell eyeglasses, also similar in Taiwan. But Japan is not so tightly regulated. So one of the companies that have cultivated that market is JINS Holdings, an SPA in eyeglasses. That is a new innovation of business format in Japan. And this is, the market size is quite large, and you have competitors such as ZOF and Owndays. And competition strategy may be to create your unique value, but compared to other competitors, It's not about which is good or bad, but what is the difference? What is the biggest difference from your competitors? The biggest difference is the way of thinking. JINS does not think it is an eyeglass store. We are not selling eyeglasses. Through vision, we want to better people's lives. Magnify life is our vision. Magnify means to expand the vision. So we want to expand the vision of our customers. That is our vision, and that's the biggest difference from others. With this vision, we have the products and services mainly, and to each of them, we have completely different approach from our competitors. For our products, quite a long time ago, we created an R&D team. R&D team in an eyeglass manufacturer. I think we are the only one to have such an R&D team. For example, blue light cutting lens or pollen cutting lens. We are having R&D team, the university researchers and ophthalmologists working together and developing these products based on evidence. That's a big difference. And on top of that, you are very strict in that functional products are not sold unless evidence is demonstrated. That's the principle, right? Yes. Our president is quite particular about that because eyes are very sensitive organ. People are quite concerned about that. So that's why we are really showing evidence. And as a result, people can use them with a peace of mind. And we can also provide functions. Yes, from an outsider's perspective, competitors are more focusing on fashionability. And SBAs can propose new things one after another, and supply chain is streamlined and cost is lower and price is lower. So some consumers want to buy eyeglasses as fashion wear. So your competitors may be going in that direction, but JINS has the R&D. And so JINS is very particular about designing and manufacturing. Uniqlo is another Porter Prize winner in the past from SBA market. I think you are quite similar to Uniqlo. Uniqlo and JINS are in different industries or markets, but are you inspired by Uniqlo? Well, yes, we are similar, but our thoughts are magnify life, and it is just the result that we are similar to Uniqlo. But there are differences from Uniqlo as well. We are selling eyeglasses, but we work with ophthalmologists. Violet light is a wave of light included in sunlight. If you have that light in your eyes for 3 hours a day, then you can limit or minimize your bad eyesight. And based on this idea, we developed a new product. So we are eyeglass shop, but we are also trying to prevent some bad eyesight. And that is because magnify life is our vision. We are always pursuing better life for our consumers, including minimizing nearsightedness. So the conclusion of that idea is the fact that you have R&D team in your organization and you work with scientists and people in the science world. Another point regarding customer contact is that in 2007, You already started e-commerce for eyeglasses. Well, eyeglasses are something that is not fitted to e-commerce. That was what people were saying originally. But then I think that e-commerce is changing in its meaning and significance. So in order to improve the purchase experience of eyeglasses, I think you developed various technologies. Can you talk a little bit about that? Yes. You usually go to a store and select eyeglasses and check your eyesight and then try out some of the eyeglasses. And 2 hours later, your eyeglasses will be complete. But is that the right approach? JINS is selling functional eyeglasses at low price, so we have democratized eyeglass market. In order for as many people as possible to enjoy eyeglasses, what do we need? Well, we need the R&D because we need resources for that. And we don't have limitless budget for that. In Japan, we don't have so many stores, but in overseas, that's more the case. We don't have too many stores. So we have the store experience as well as e-commerce experience. Customers select the eyeglasses and check their eyesight and try out and get the eyeglasses. But this customer journey should be available both in EC and in stores. We can check how well the eyeglasses go with the face size and the face shape. We use AI for that diagnosis. And people who have eyesight problem will have to remove their eyeglasses before trying on new eyeglasses. Then they might not be able to see very well if they look good in the eyeglasses. But then using this function, they can see if the new eyeglasses look well on top of the existing eyeglasses. So it's called eyeglass on eyeglass feature. So it's like zoom screen, and then digitally you can try on the eyeglasses. Usually I wear glasses myself. And using that feature, as you just said, on top of the glasses that you're wearing, you have the glasses. Obviously, people who buy glasses are already wearing glasses, so that's true. That is a very interesting experience. Yes, I think it's important to stay on top of things. We believe that we should focus on the technology. A fitting box is a French digital service company for eyeglass trials, and it's one of the leading companies around the world. We are working with this company, and we have a capital partnership. So we would like to become a number one in terms of trying on eyeglasses. Now, Osono-san, do we have questions coming in? Yes. So I'm going to pick one of them. From Saifuru-san, we have a question. As Professor Noma said, profitability is very high compared to other players. Yes, and ROIC as well. ROIC, the difference is quite big, but ROS is also different. ROS. No, we don't call it ROS. But as you said, the price is low and you talked about customer experience a lot. I think that the cost structure is also quite concentrated and focused. So I'd like to ask you about cost. Okay. One of the big characteristics of JINS Holdings is that the unit price is low, but gross margin is high. Okay. So I think that is a strength, which means cost is low, right? Yes. When the unit price is high, then the number of unit of sales is not high. But then we have gross margin, which is high, and then cost is low. So I think that is the biggest factor. That's the basis. Yes. And as SBA, you are producing, designing and producing these eyeglasses yourselves, and you are mass producing them. So that's the economy of scale. But you don't have your own factory. How you are creating your structure of supply chain is something that you have pioneered in eyeglass market. Is there something that you are very unique about that others cannot copy? Well, as you said, scale is a very big factor. With one single brand selling these many eyeglasses, I don't think any other companies are doing that other than ourselves. So gross margin is high and economy of scale is achieved. These are the big elements. And suppliers are also present working with JINS, right? Yes. So I think that the scale is a benefit for your suppliers as well, and that is contributed to the cost, isn't it? Yes. We have these many lenses and eyeglasses that are being sold. So that is leading to cost reduction. And we can also jointly develop products together. That is a competitive edge. Next question, Yumi-san and Hon-san asked similar questions. You are launching many interesting products. There is a recent item that is tinted, which it's called cheek lens, which makes the person wearing the eyeglasses look as if the person is wearing makeup on. So we do understand the technology, but what about the seeds or origin of ideas for new development? Do you have any mechanism for that? Well, it's not about mechanism or system. It's more about culture. The magnified life, this vision is really taking root among the employees. So magnify life. What attitudes should we have to achieve that? We have progressive, inspiring, honest. These are the attitudes that we should have. Progressive, meaning we should be progressive and aggressive and honest, being sincere and inspiring, being able to engage others. And I think that progressive is really a strong feature of JINS Holdings. We want to be active, aggressive, and progressive. So we have a culture of accepting something being done. A lot of ideas are generated in many places and that are being realized. It's because of this culture. In the end, you may fail, but you are not scared or afraid of the failure. That's right. You won't be told to leave the company even if you fail. Any other questions? From overseas, well, you have Taiwan and Chinese operations. Why are you in these two markets? And what's your plan next? Well, Taiwan, China has a big market. So we decided that we should definitely go to this big market. Now, Taiwan in Asia, people in Taiwan are very friendly to Japanese people. So we thought that it would be easy for us to do business there. But going forward, in order to achieve magnify life vision, we need to go to overseas market more. Western countries in Asia are different. For Western countries, looking at the labor cost, our business model as is won't fit the Western countries. The digital aspect that I just talked about need to be promoted further to fit our business into Western countries. And in Asia, we believe that we can still compete against others if we sophisticate our business and cultivate into Asia market. Own days are already in overseas market. Right, own days started in overseas market and then came to Japan later. So they are exploring and pursuing opportunities. So it's interesting, but on the other hand, JINS is really focusing on manufacturing and R&D. It's not that which is good or bad, but the strategy and methods are quite opposite. You now have 400 or more stores in Japan and 170 or 180 stores in China and 40 outlets in Taiwan. And these overseas ratio will increase further. Right, we want to deliver our products to many people in overseas market. So JINS originates from Japan. Do Chinese and Taiwanese people know that? Yes, especially in Taiwan. Taiwanese people strongly feel that JINS comes from Japan, and they know that we have a strength in manufacturing. And we have survival items as well. They are quite popular in Taiwan. Okay. The new customer experience. Because even if you are not planning to buy eyeglasses, I want everyone to try that experience. So I pray for further success of your company. Thank you very much for joining us today.
This concludes the interviews with top leaders of three companies receiving Porter Prize. Porter Prize will continue, so friends watching today's conference, please, why don't you apply for Porter Prize? Through the process of applying to Porter Prize, we can learn from you. And I think your company can learn about your strategy and also think about your future strategy and deepen your thoughts. I think it is a wonderful tool to deep dive into your own company. Until someone tells me to quit, I will continue to be a part of Porter Prize as member of organizing committee. I truly hope to see you again next year. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for participating in Porter Prize Conference on Competitiveness 2021. Three companies receiving Porter Prize today. Their strategies will be explained from the perspective of Porter Prize. It will be on our website, and also the past companies. We have a history of 2 decades already, so they have companies which face drastic environmental change after receiving Porter Prize. We have a follow-up article too for some of the companies. So I want you to take a look at that too. Porter Prize, you will never receive it if you don't apply. So please consider about applying for Porter Prize. Just after end of May, so beginning of June, we'll be opening the window to welcome you to apply for Porter Prize. Thank you very much for participation, and see you again. Thank you.